Once we have all of our parts back from the machinist, it's time to actually get stuck in and start assembling your new engine. While there's obviously a lot of tasks to complete as part of the assembly, the first place to start is with the block preparation. This is actually an area of the engine building process that even some professional engine builders tend to overlook, but in my opinion, it's an essential place to start as it can highlight potential problems before we invest too much time and effort into the assembly. Proper block preparation can also prevent issues that can crop up later on as we progress through the engine building process. So what does the term block preparation mean? And what should you be doing? This really starts with you unpacking your freshly machined block and getting it onto an engine stand. While it's possible to build your new motor with the block sitting on a workbench, this at best is going to be tricky, and the engine stand gives us the ability to quickly and easily turn the block over, which gives us easy access to all of the parts on the block that you'll be working on. Once you have the block on an engine stand, it's a good time to have a thorough examination of all of the block surfaces. What we're looking for here is any sign of damage to the block surfaces that could affect your finished engine. It's not uncommon, for example, to see a mark on the deck surface of the block as a result of contact with another component during shipping. A mark like this could be sufficient to affect the head sealing, and this is going to be much more expensive to correct later on once the engine is up and running and it's found that the head gasket is leaking, compared to now when we've just got the engine sitting on an engine stand. Once the block has passed your visual examination, it's time to clean up all of the threaded holes in the block. Particularly if you've got a high mileage engine block or one that's been sourced from a wrecking yard, then you're likely to find all manner of dirt and debris hidden away inside the factory head bolt and main cap bolt holes. If this debris isn't removed, it can affect your ability to easily insert your new bolts or studs during the assembly process. In turn, this can affect the torque reading while you're tightening these fasteners, which can mean that you're not reaching the manufacturer's recommended clamping force. While we're most interested in the fasteners that are critical to the engine's performance and reliability, it's also a good idea to complete the same treatment on the external bolt holes of the engine block. There's nothing worse than snapping off an engine mount bolt into the block because the threaded hole is partially blocked with dirt. While there are specific thread chasing taps that you can purchase for this task, you can also do a perfectly adequate job using a clean and sharp tap of the correct thread size and pitch. Particularly for any blind holes, such as the head bolt holes which don't go the entire way through the block, you want to use what's referred to as a bottoming tap, which is designed to allow you to clean up the threads all the way to the bottom of these bolt holes. Once the threaded holes have been cleaned up, you can move on to deburring the engine block. This process uses a variety of tools in order to remove casting flash from the inside of the engine block, as well as to remove sharp edges. Casting flash is a result of the way the engine block is manufactured, and is something you'll see in many production engine blocks along the parting lines of the individual parts of the casting molds. While this casting flash may not be an issue for a road car engine, under the additional stresses and loads associated with high RPM and high power use, it's possible for some of this casting flash to break away and then cause damage to your expensive new engine. Fortunately, you can easily remove this casting flash using a few cheap tools. The quickest and easiest of these tools is an air die grinder, and with the right grinding burr, you can usually access even the tightest spots in the engine block. Alternatively, I'll sometimes use a power file with a 40 or 60 grit belt. The power file has the advantage of being able to remove a lot of material quickly, but the downside is that it's not going to be able to access tight spots. When you're deburring the engine block like this, you don't need to try and achieve a polished finish. All you're trying to do is remove the casting flash that could potentially break off, and the finished block should look something like this. While you're at it, in some blocks we can actually improve the oil flow by grinding away and smoothing some of the sharp edges in the oil galleries. This is going to depend on the specific block you're working with, but oil doesn't really like turning sharp corners, so if the oil has to flow around a lot of 90 degree angles and sharp surfaces, it's worth spending some time to smooth these out and help the oil get where it's needed. The next process you'll want to go through is deburring the sharp edges of the machined surfaces of the block. I'm talking here about surfaces such as the deck surface of the block. However, it's good practice to continue this process onto all of the edges of the block. The machining process can leave small burrs of material that again can break free and travel through the engine with potentially catastrophic results. This task needs to be treated with a little care since, understandably, if you slip with a die grinder, you could end up doing some pretty nasty damage to the deck surface of the block. I find the best tool for this work is an electric die grinder like this Dremel. This is a smaller and lighter version of the air die grinder that we've already looked at, and it allows a little bit of added control and some extra precision. Deburring these surfaces simply requires running the burr of the Dremel tool across the edges of the block in order to break down any burrs and remove those sharp edges. This deburring process does end up creating a lot of debris, so it should go without saying that a thorough cleaning of the engine block is also going to be essential when you're done. In particular, you should start by removing any of the oil gallery plugs to allow you to thoroughly clean out these areas using engine cleaning brushes and brake clean along with compressed air. Once you've got your engine block prepped and cleaned, you're ready to move on with the assembly. However, if your block is cast iron, you're also going to want to give the outside surfaces a couple of coats of paint in order to protect the surface from corrosion. With our third lesson now complete, we're ready to begin the actual assembly of our engine. In our fourth and final lesson, we're going to cover some of the tools that you're going to require for the assembly process of your engine. And here we're going to be debunking the myth that you're going to have to spend thousands of dollars on specialist tools if you want to build your own engine. The reality, as you'll see, is that nothing could be further from the truth.
If you like that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson.